Good afternoon and welcome back, everybody. I hope you had a good lunch. I did a little bit of walking because sitting all morning on my chair, well, you get a little bit stiff. And welcome, especially to the people who weren't able to join this morning. I can imagine that if you're living in Canada or America or South America, that starting in the morning at 9 o'clock Paris time is a little bit too early. It's in the middle of the night, but in the afternoon, it's a little bit later in Asia. So I can imagine that people from Hong Kong or Australia thinks, well, it's evening time, maybe I got to do something else. Well, never mind. I hope you're still within this. If it's not possible, you can review all the videos later on. It will be posted tomorrow. So don't worry, but I'm happy you're there. And let me know in the chat where you're watching. If what country you come from, what city you come from. It's nice to see who's hooked on this moment. Because it's 7:30 in the morning in Washington, Miami, Montreal. It's still 4:30 a.m. at night in Los Angeles. It's 7:30 in Beijing and Hong Kong. And in Sydney, it's already 9:30. Well, this afternoon program has two sections. First, a session about focus on Africa, where satellites are very important. And around 2:50, 2:15, a decade of the ocean for sustainable development will be discussed. And in the end, we have got something with this. But more about it later. We call this a teaser. First of all, I hope you can all join in. If something doesn't work on Swapcard, please just refresh. And then there's a big possibility things will work. And if it's still not working, I'm chatting with the moderators. Help! Something goes wrong. So they're working on it. And I think everything will be fine. Put in the chat every remark, nice suggestions. Where are you watching? Use the question part for asking questions to the speakers. And if not possible to answer the questions, they can answer it later on in that question part. So please ask your question. It's your opportunity to do so. And we have a poll session. I heard in the end of the morning, some people say, I can't see the poll. Well, I do hope you can see the poll right now because there are questions in it, and I want to ask the question, how would you evaluate the level of awareness of climate change in Africa? Very good, or just good, or acceptable, or low, or even very low? You can fill in the poll, and it will take a few seconds before it's the second question in the poll, so go a little bit to the bottom. We have two speakers, as you saw in the beginning of the session. We have Vincent Caballo. I had practice on the name. And we have Leanne Simpson. Welcome both in this session. Leanne, later on we'll go to you. If you don't mind, I'll first go to Vincent. Vincent works at UMITSAT since more than 10 years in the division of the Charge of Strategy, Communication and International Relations. Officially, he's called an International Relation Officer at UMITSAT. Vincent, tell us how UMITSAT delivers data in near real time to the African National Weather Services, thus supporting their positive impact on the African sustainable development. I'm curious.
Yes, Helga. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for this nice introduction. Hello to Leanne also. Very nice to see you in these sessions too, from the other side of the African continent. So I would like first maybe before giving you some more details about how we send or we send our data to Africa or they are used, and Leanne will also complement and show you a very good example of the use of our data in Africa. The first question is why those EUMETSAT is so present over Africa. And because EUMETSAT, we are a European organization. We have 30 member states of in Europe, as you say, as you have heard this morning. But when you look at one image of our METOSAT satellite, what do you see on that one? Obviously, you see a little bit of Europe, but the most obvious continent that you see is Africa. So our satellites are located over Africa. And what they see best is this African continent. So since the very beginning of EUMETSAT, our member states have always included in our strategy some activities, the objective that we should serve the user community in Africa, especially in easing access to our data, and also making some training, ensuring that they have the capacities to use those data. I will come back on that. Obviously, our satellites are over Africa, and it's mainly the METOSAT generation of satellites since more than 40 years. And at the last part of my presentation, I will introduce the METOSAT third generation. I'm sure you have already had some other presentation on that, but it will have also a very significant improvement over Africa. We'll come back on that. So these 40 years of data over Africa have allowed increase their capacities and develop several added value services. I just will give a few examples, and Liane will give you much more practical ones. One of them will be the dust storm. I will come back on that. Also, you can see on this image is a special, what we call the combination of red, green, and blue channel of the instruments, where this special combination allows you to see much better all what is dust or aerosol. One other obvious application from our METOSAT satellite in terms of nowcasting is to follow up the cyclones. And you know that in the Indian Ocean, there is quite a frequent cyclone also over the Atlantic. Those cyclones generally are born on the coast of Africa, and our satellites play an important role also. Another type of satellites is this image, this nice colorful image comes from the Sentinel-3, the satellite we operate from the Copernicus program, which is a program of the European Union. And EUMETSAT is one entity that operates those Sentinel satellites from this Copernicus program. On this one, you see C-color temperature, and this is also a very interesting parameters for some specific application. I will come back on that. 40 years of data over Africa means also quite that we can also very much contribute to climate monitoring, because with 40 years of data, we can build what we call climate data records, and we can show anomalies of temperature seasons. By example, here you have an example about the southern part of Africa, and you see the last 2 years were particularly hot. And if you compare that to other parameters that we measure with our satellite, like the vegetation, you can easily detect drought seasons and the conditions that generated this drought. So it's very nice to have those beautiful satellites over Africa, taking a lot of nice images every 15 minutes with METOSAT. We have also other satellites like the Sentinel-3 or the METOP or the JSON satellite, which takes additional measurements and observation of various parameters, atmospheric, land, marine, oceans parameters. But for our users in Africa, there is three main issues. The first one is how to access the data. Obviously, it's a huge volume of data and is not easy. And you know that in some countries, internet is not that good. So this is a first issue. The second one is obviously how to use the data, how to interpret them, how to what they need to look in those satellite data, and what's the format also, how to integrate them in their software. The last third question I would like to tackle today is how to create added value services, because obviously if you have a meteorologist which can get access to data, can interpret the data, if he's not providing a services to his citizen or to other national institutions, Obviously, the satellite data will not have any impact on the real life and for the citizens in Africa. So this is the three aspects that we at EUMETSAT over the last 20 years, we have tried to develop, improve, and help our user communities to tackle these three challenges. The first one is about data access. The first thing is they need to know which data exists. Obviously, that's also, we have quite a lot of data. We have some big data catalog. And the first barrier, I will say, is to be aware that those data exist. Then I was mentioning it already, the poor internet connectivities. And this is even more stringent because for weather forecasters, obviously, they need to get access to the data less than 5 minutes after they have been observed. And we do a new observation every 15 minutes. So normally 5 minutes is the time we allow ourselves between the observation from the satellites and when the data get to the user so that he can use it. In terms of awareness, we try, even during the COVID time, to try to do our best. We have already did several webinars focusing on Africa. There was one on METHOSAT third generation. There will be one also, there have been one last week, actually, on climate monitoring from space for Africa. We are doing also user forum. That was the last one in physical presence. It was 2018. We had planned one in 2020, but we will do it online this year and resume with physical meeting next year. We work also with expert group. Liane, which we'll speak after, is actually the chair person of the expert group for satellite meteorology, and we have also an help desk. So we try our best really to stay in contact with our users in Africa, to try to understand their needs, for them also to understand what is our future plan so that they can get ready, by example, for the next generation of satellites or for new products that we disseminate over Africa. How to access the data? As I say, there is very poor internet in some countries, and we have quite a lot, big quantity of data that we need to disseminate to a lot of users at the same time. So the best technology that we have taken actually, that we are using for this, is digital video broadcasting. So it's by satellite, by using a telecommunication satellite, and it's like TV. If you have TV per satellite, you can have with very similar dishes also access to the EUMETSAT data, but not only, we also broadcast the data from ICMWF, by example, or from the Copernicus program through this type of channel. So it's a data push system. And the users in Africa needs a dishes like this. It's a bit bigger than a TV dish because it needs to be more robust to bad weather, by example, and things like that. And they need also then to have computers that can ingest the data and show them in some various screen. And here you have a team at the University of Zimbabwe who have just get a station and it was during the instructions, during the installation of the station. I really love this image. It's a picture made of about 200 pictures, all taken in Africa. It's pictures of several dishes and EUMETCAST reception stations that our African user communities are using. And you see the shape of Africa with these pictures. So this is also a good opportunity to tell you that we have a bit more than 400 users actually in Africa that receive our data in real time and making use of it. This course also opened a lot of effort of training, and here we work in partnership with four training centers in Africa, one in Morocco, one in Niger, one in Kenya, and one in South Africa, where Liane is actually. And we do mainly training of the trainers. We keep their help them keeping their training material up to date, and they do deliver the training in their respective regions. The last big barrier, I will say, is how to create added value services. And here, EUMETSAT, we are mainly a data provider. So our role is really to operate the satellites, get the data, and push them as soon as possible to Africa. In order for them to create added value services, we have teamed up with different partners in order to real capacities in Africa for this service delivery chain. And we have we are in partnership with the European Commission, with the African Union and the African Development Bank at the level of donors and policymakers, but also with lots of various regional and national institutions. So since more than 20 years, we have been involved in several projects that have supported Africa not only to get access to the data and be trained, but also to develop added value services. I will just like to speak about the two last one, which is the GMES on Africa program, which is currently between phase one and phase two. The phase one is finishing this year and we'll have a phase two starting in 2022. And this program is mainly focusing on developing added value services for marine environment, coastal management, but also water management, land and agriculture monitoring. We have another one that has been just launched actually virtually this year. It was officially started in 2019, but there was a slow start of this program and there was an official launching in March this year. And this program is more focusing on climate services. So how to transform climate knowledge into actionable actions for the decision makers. Program, as you have seen also with our satellites, we can generate some long-term climate data records, and this program is also supporting the access to various sources of climate data for African weather services to be able to access those data, but to develop also added value services. Here it's a few examples of those added value services that have been developed in Africa. One is linked to the dust storm that I showed before, and you might know that the dust is not only carrying dust particles, sand particles, but also bacteria, and this creates meningitis. So if you can monitor the sandstorm, and by example here with our colleague from the Spanish Met Service make predictions where those sandstorms will go, then you can start creating a vigilance map. This is one created by ACMAD for the Sahelian regions about the risk of meningitis outbreak. And those type of map are then taken into account by, here it's an example of the Nigerian Emergency Management Agency, who is then warning the population, but also the Ministry of Health in this region, in Nigeria in this case, about the risk of meningitis. Another one that is well known is the cyclone, so very well seen by your satellites. Weather forecasters can then make predictions about the trajectory of cyclones and warn population about the risk and the necessity to protect goods, properties, and protect also life of the population. And you might know that in the Ocean Indian, the trajectory of cyclones is actually much more difficult to predict than in the Atlantic Ocean. Last one is about the algae bloom. So with this type of images that you see at the beginning, we can see the color of the ocean, which is also an indication about the type of alga that is there and where the fish are. And there is also the possibilities to see a bit in advance the development of harmful alga bloom, which have a negative effect on the fish, obviously, because those alga are quite toxic. But also if people start eating those fishes, it creates also some toxic food, and some people might even die about that. So, just to let you, and in order to mitigate this type of risk, we have had during the MESA project, one of these antenna reception station of satellite data that's been installed in the Indian Ocean, more specifically here in Madagascar, to support the authorities in detecting those harmful algae bloom on times before it's too late. So what's next? So for the moment, I mean, there have been a lot of efforts to make sure that the data from the current generation of satellites are being used and can be transformed into efficient services. We will have the challenge of the Meteosat third generations. First, it's a big opportunity because it will offer continuity of the observation, but the quantity of data will be very high. And this is also the source of some challenges that we need to tackle together with our African user community. So first, at the level of opportunities, also for Africans, better spatial and time resolutions will allow better forecasting over the continent, and seeing also some typical phenomena like sandstorm or fire, which are very much present in Africa, in a much more precise way as it is the case today. We will have also a new instrument, which is a lightning imager, which will be very important for Africa, because on those continents, they do not have, or only a few countries have radar data. And so they are missing sometimes some information about weather front and thunderstorm, and lightning imager will be a very important source of information for them to do mainly no-casting for aviation, or also protection of life and properties in some area like for the Lake Victoria, which is the region in the world with the highest flash density. So a very important instrument for Africa that will come with the Meteosat third generation. The challenge is that there will be about 30 times more data, and we have been working since quite some years now with Lian and the RIDEC group, the expert group, in order to prioritize which data will be most important and to ensure continuity, but also to allow the African user community to take little step by step the full benefit of this Meteosat third generation. There is also a good political awareness of this, and we have had some meeting at high level with the colleague of the African Union and the regional economic communities for them to also support the mobilization of resources to help African user communities to make this transition from Meteosat second generation to Meteosat third generation. So this is for us and for African user communities one of the biggest challenges for the next 3, 4, 5 years, probably, into having a successful transitions between the current satellite generation and the next one, so that they can not only ensure continuity of the services they are providing based on the satellite data, but also improve those services. Thank you, Helga, for listening to my presentation.
Oh, Vincent, thank you very much. I must admit, then, when you said about the dust and the complications of dust, like meningitis, I was like, I never realized that. So that's a part of communication that I missed so far. Where can we find that kind of information? Is that included if you show the pictures of the dust and then you say, okay, this is the hazardous issues around it, or?
This specific services has been more developed by ACMAD, which is African Center of for Meteorological Application for Development, and they are probably the best to tell you the stories about this meningitis outbreak and how satellites support that. And they have worked together with the World Health Organization in order to make sure that they find the right users actually for this type of services. So
Public link, because you might know that a lot of weather presenters and journalists are watching, and if there's something important, then it is tell why focusing on Africa and what's going on there and what that means for the whole food chain, the security chain, the migration chain. It's all connected. So if there's a link or anywhere, I think it's a great way for communication, even though we don't have complete access to the data as well. Is there a link or something?
I will look at that and send it through the chat.
Yeah, and if the chat is kicked out after the session, maybe it's also possible to put it in a partner section, or in the coffee lounge, whatever. There's a reason to go to the coffee lounge. Yeah, please, if you want to do so. Yeah, there's another question coming in. Somebody noticed that among the countries mentioned concerning the training of the trainers, the countries of Central Africa are not included. What for, and what are the prospects plans for this sub-region of Africa?
So we are not excluding any region. So for the moment, we have indeed this the four training centers. First, we do not only we train trainers from these training centers, but they, the trainer themselves can come from various countries. And what our approach so far has been to have two Anglophone and two Francophones. We have Morocco and Niger in French, and Kenya and South Africa in English, but they train people from all the regions. And so far, the people from Central Africa have gone to the school in Niger, EAMAC, which is the ASECNA school. We are working also very closely with the new regional climate centers, which is located in Douala. It has been created 2-3 years ago. There have been a first project to help them strengthening and putting in place their first capacities. And they do also have organized, they have a training rooms there, and they do have also organized some training. We don't use them.
They are trained and they get information.
Yes, but for the moment, they are not yet recognized by WMO as a center of excellence for training. This will be some discussion that we'll have to do. But for the moment, with these four training centers, we are able to cover all the regions in Africa.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you very much. Finchet Caballo. Caballo.
Thank you, Helga. Vincent is fine. Prego, okay, prego.
Thank you, Finn. Let's go to poll number 6. I hope you can, people who are watching, go to the poll. What sort of actions could be taken to mitigate the impact of climate change in Africa? Or have any of these actions already been taken? And there are a few answers possible. Improvement in major cities to build climate resilience. Technical advantage to make renewable energies more attainable. Actions taken, well, look into the poll, I believe it. You can see it in a poll and fill it in, please. The more people react, the more easy it is for all the speakers to say something about it. Now, our next speaker is Lee Ann Simpson. She's a meteorological trainer at the South African Weather Service, specializing in public weather forecasting and satellite meteorology. Hello, Lian.
A very good afternoon to you, Helga. It's good to be here.
Yeah, well, thank you. You live in Pretoria in South Africa, and you wrote, "The weather is just perfect, and we're close to game parks and other exciting places to visit." Well, I hope it's possible with all the COVID stuff around. And what makes you happy is good food, family, and interesting weather, recognizable. And in your spare time, you do outdoor activities, mountain biking, hiking, white water kayaking. What's white water kayaking?
That's when you wait for lots of rain to fall and you get into a small plastic boat and you head down a river and go through the rapids and the white water, so the foamy, bubbly water. We don't have a lot of it in South Africa, but we have enough to keep us occupied. It's one of those activities that I've picked up since meeting my husband. And there are some nervous moments, I will admit that, but very, very enjoyable sport.
And I ask every speaker, what can I wake you up for the middle of the night? And you're the only one said, don't even try. We'll let you sleep. Lian, please, can you tell us a little bit more about the current use of Eumetsat data, the early warning forecasts and climate monitoring?
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Helga. And a very good afternoon from a wonderfully sunny South Africa today. And I'm so glad to be in these sessions and following on from what Vincent was saying just a few minutes ago. This slide show that you're going to see now from me ties into that quite closely. So as a meteorologist, we see weather and we use the weather satellites, obviously, for cloud type identification and weather system identification. But those other uses, as Vincent was saying about meningitis, there's health issues that we can link to weather as well. Down in Southern Africa and actually many parts of Africa, the occurrence of malaria and things like that are linked into weather as well. And to be able to see how weather impacts so many people's lives, their livelihoods, even their interest factors, and particularly when we come into these forums and we see the diversity of participants and the diversity of presenters, we realize how wide this topic really is. And as a recipient of weather satellite data and a user of that data, there are so many applications, and we only really brush the top of it. If we look at these applications that we have, one of the huge ones is for weather forecasting and nowcasting. So weather forecasting and nowcasting fits quite nicely into my box of tricks that I have. But this is the common one that most people see. And if we're thinking about weather presenting or broadcast meteorology and those kind of aspects, this is what a lot of those industries have got access to. They see the forecast. What a lot of people don't realize is what is happening in the background. And this is what we see here in the other four bullet points. Data assimilation, which is where we actually take data that's derived from the satellite and put it into other products to help with evaluating how accurate those products are, also to give them extra information. So when you're predicting the weather, even if you're predicting seasonally or climatologically or just in the next few days, the accuracy of your data is what at the end of the day is going to depict how accurate your forecast is. So by using satellite information as an input into some of these prediction models is very important. The climate monitoring, as Vincent was showing as well, the satellite data gives us the ability to always look at the same portion of the Earth. So something like the Meteosat second generation geostationary satellite stays in one point and it monitors the same point all the time. So the whole of Africa is monitored 24 hours a day, every 15 minutes, which gives you an amazingly accurate and reliable data source to be able to see changes in temperature that we can then have a look at and try and work those back into other products. We also use the satellite data to verify and evaluate weather forecasts. So if we've been forecasting conditions over a certain area for a certain time span, the satellite data is our real-time verification. We can see in reality where the systems are, what the systems are. We can even derive forms of intensity of those systems. And that helps us, again, to be able to predict more accurately. And those weather predictions are not always long-term predictions. Sometimes those are early warning systems. Sometimes those are impact-based alerts. And these are alerts and warnings that need to be adhered to immediately to be able to save lives and to mitigate damage. Then there's the marine services products and monitoring. And this is a very big field for what the satellite data can be used for. So there's various aspects of the marine environment that can be monitored. And of course, we know that with climate monitoring as well, the oceans and the sea is very, very important to be able to keep up with what's going on. The way that we do this, or the way that UMETSAT does this, is that they are what we call the SAF facilities or the satellite application facilities. And these are almost guidance facilities for the applications that the satellite can help you with. So these applications actually get shared to many countries across the world, and they're also populated. So everybody can have inputs into these facilities. They also make use of them. They put a lot of information into one place that people can gain access to information and data to be able to help with the various product production. So these are some of the satellite application facilities that UMETSAT and the member states are involved with. Starting off with atmospheric composition, there's the climate monitoring SAF, land surface analysis, numerical weather prediction, radio occultation, the ocean and sea ice SAF, the nowcasting and very short-range forecasting SAF, and then operational hydrology. So you can see with these eight applications that are out there, this is some of what the satellite data can be used for. As Vincent was saying, there are multiple satellites out there. So some are good for monitoring weather systems, others are good for monitoring land use, others are good for monitoring the ocean. They're all collecting different types of data. So whether we're looking at the Sentinel or JSON or the METOP program or MSG and the coming MTG, there's a tool for all of these applications, and it's not necessarily the same tool. And that's a very important aspect with satellite meteorology, is we are provided with many tools. We have a very full toolbox, and it's very important to always select the correct tool for what you want to use it for. In Africa, we're very, very lucky and privileged to be able to have access to this data. As we saw, the footprint of the satellite is directly over Africa. And so we get very reliable data. And this data gets used for many things. Understanding that in Africa, network connectivity is not always available, and it's not always of good quality, but also infrastructure can be very limited. So very few countries in Africa have access to radar data or lightning imager data. And so satellite data covers all of these aspects of the weather monitoring. And the three different types of satellites that are helping with this. At the moment, we're using MSG, which is going to be replaced by MTG in the next 2 years. And then we'll get the imagery from that at a higher resolution, also more often, and with a few tweaks on a few of the channels. And then there's the METOP series, which are the polar orbiting satellites, and they are collecting data basically from the ground. They are much closer to the surface of the Earth, and they have a totally different use for satellite data. For example, when we are looking at Meteosat's second generation image, we are looking at Africa as a whole and most of the Atlantic Ocean. And again, we can also see Europe with that and across to South America. So for us here in South Africa, where I am, we are very, very fortunate to be able to watch the weather systems approaching our country and to be able to predict what the changes in weather would be. The METOP series, or the polar orbiting satellites, they can collect wind information data, for example, is one of their uses. And here we can see the METOP collecting scatterometer data from the surface of the ocean and giving us some wind speed and direction information. And that's also with an approaching tropical cyclone. This is Madagascar to the left-hand side. And we can see that the eye of the tropical cyclone is in very, very well positioned with where the METOP data is also seeing the wind speeds to be converging into a point. So we have the ability to mix and match. So the background image here is a Meteosat second generation image, and it's overlaid with a METOP image. So we can use these satellite data sets together to be able to add more value to the products that we have. Some of the other applications, and very important applications, are early warning systems, and that includes what is now becoming a norm in many countries, which is impact-based forecasting. So instead of forecasting what the weather will be, we forecast what the weather will do. So what will the impact of the weather be on particularly vulnerable communities? So in Africa, we saw, you know, with dust, with flooding, with heavy rainfall, severe thunderstorms, large weather systems like tropical cyclones bringing in wind and rainfall damage. These are aspects that we can focus on and where the satellite imagery can help us. Fire detection is another one. So we have got the APHIS system, which is detecting fires across the African continent using the Meteosat second generation data. And this is very important for all kinds of business and, of course, safety on the ground, but also the protection of infrastructure. So, for example, our power utility down in South Africa has power lines running across the country, and our country has got a lot of vegetation in many areas, and this vegetation can burn. And so if there are fires in these areas where we have the power lines, and we can the utility would be aware of this, and they would be able to mitigate that risk. Then we can use the satellite data for nowcasting, which is the very short range forecasting. So immediate, up to 30 minutes, sort of up to about 3 hours ahead of time, we can see where heavy rainfall or severe thunderstorms are possible and alert the correct authorities and public, or even if it's the media, if we can get our message out via broadcast media or radio, then we can alert people in the correct areas that something untoward is heading their way. With data assimilation, and I spoke earlier about putting satellite data into products, we do that in South Africa. And this is known as the flash flood guidance system of ours. And we can see in this little area that's been highlighted here how much rainfall is required over the next 3 hours for there to be a flash flood. And so we can actually highlight areas here. You can see the purple means that very little rainfall is required, and then we would have the risk of flooding in that district. And the input from the satellite helps us with that to make that more and more accurate. For climate monitoring, it's extremely important to be able to monitor what is happening and, of course, what is changing. So changes happen very slowly climatologically. Changes don't happen day by day. We have to look at a very long period of time and a very large data set. And when we see those changes happening, we can compare it with previous years or previous seasons or previous decades even to be able to see is there a general rise or a general fall in temperatures. And from that, we can learn. And of course, we can then start to, as Vincent was showing, you can start comparing these data sets. When we saw some drier or warmer conditions, how did that relate in some of the other sectors like agriculture and health? Where are we seeing that there's a link? And then, of course, you want to link these two things together because now you have a new stakeholder that you can identify and you can work with them to be able to understand what are their needs, what are their vulnerabilities, and how can we address that. And on the African continent, this is so incredibly important because, as I was saying, the access to information and data, and we saw there's sporadic areas that are getting information, but the satellite data is available to everyone. And so by being able to work together as a community through the satellite application facilities or the SAFs, we get these inputs and we can deliver products and focus products on the needs of the African community in particular.
So, okay, are you almost to the end? Yeah, don't hate to interrupt you, but I see the time going on.
Yes, I am almost to the end. I love speaking, so it's a problem.
I know, please, sorry.
Finish. No, it's fine. And so we can collect information like albedo, cloud coverage, and vegetation coverage. And then the last one that we have is the marine products and services, where altimetry, ocean color, and sea surface temperatures help us to be able to understand what is happening in the ocean surface. Most of this is happening from the METOP and Copernicus kind of projects, the polar orbiting satellites. And coming up is MTG, which Vincent also spoke a little bit about. And for that, we're having increased spatial resolution, more channels, enhanced combinations, but of course, the Lightning Imager, which is making me very excited to be able to monitor the lightning from space. And here's a few examples of what we see at the moment on the left-hand side and what we can expect to see from MTG with a higher resolution and better quality of imagery and seeing it more often as well. Lightning Imager, we can overlay into the storms to see where the most active part of our storms are. My big saying with MTG, for Africa, let's be a participant, not a recipient. And let's work together, collaborate, research, train, as the colleague from the Central African Republic asking, what about us? And that is the duty of Africa, is to set up material, to make connections, and to make sure that we all learn together. So that is what I have. Thank you very much for your time. Sorry, I ran a little bit over, but I could speak about this all day. I'm very passionate about this
about
being able to help and to get this into Africa as much as possible.
Well, if you have some nice links to share, you please put it into the chat function so we can look after that. I don't see any other questions, so that's your time. That's great. For everybody who says, as soon as the program is over time, your window might go to the official program and you see very small the presentation. Just refresh your browser and then you'll get it enlarged again. So that's the tip for the rest of the day. Hopefully we don't get overtime anymore. But thank you so far, Vincent and Leanne. Thank you for your contribution. That's very important. And one thing I get out, don't tell what the weather is like. Just tell us what the weather will do. I'll keep that in mind. Great. Thank you. We're going to have a small real break because we have to switch to the next speakers. And that is just a technical issue. That means 5 minutes, grab a cup of coffee or tea and hold your screen. See you later. 5 minutes.